The novel coronavirus has a new name, and there's a ton of new misinformation out there. We're gonna stay alert and not anxious on this week's Wednesday Checkup. The date today is February 18th, 2020. I need you to know that because all the information I'm about to give you is relevant up until this date. Things change really quickly, especially when it comes to new viruses like this. Let's kick it off by talking about the new name of the novel coronavirus, COVID-19. CO from corona, VI from virus, D for disease, 19, because it actually started in December 2019. Actually, it was a World Health Organization that decided to give the novel coronavirus the COVID-19 title, and they worked really hard on this because they wanted to avoid a few really important setbacks. Number one, they didn't want to include the location because it comes with a lot of stereotyping. People were calling this the Chinese coronavirus, the Wuhan coronavirus. That's not what we're calling it. They wanted to avoid implicating any animal in this because, as we've seen with the H1N1 virus, people started referring to it as swine flu, other ones as the bird flu. This has nothing to do with animals. Yes, it started in an animal vector, but now it's within humans. There's no need to get animals involved. The International Committee of Taxonomy for Viruses started saying that maybe we should call it SARS-CoV-2, but the WHO was like, no, don't, even though it's somewhat related to SARS, don't put SARS in the title. That's only gonna scare people. And I agree with them. COVID-19, that's where I stand. I think that's the best title for it. Now, let's get to the updated numbers. Currently, we have 73,000 cases of COVID-19 with 1,900 deaths as a result of this virus. Now, that being said, there was a huge spike in the numbers of those who were infected as well as deaths last week on Thursday. A lot of people started to panic. They started to think that the virus was worsening in its intensity and its spread. And that was not happening. What changed and why this number went up so drastically from one day to the next was because in the center of where all this is happening, the Hubei province where Wuhan, China is located, they changed their way of identifying who has the virus. They were simply running low on testing kits, so they decided to do something smart. Those who showed clinical symptoms of COVID-19 and were exposed to COVID-19 were diagnosed with it. That's pretty much what I do in my office with the flu. That's called a clinical diagnosis. If you see someone with a cough, shortness of breath, fever, and exposure to the COVID-19 virus, they have it. You don't need to do a kit in that area. This doesn't apply to the rest of the world, but in Hubei province, it makes a lot of sense. So yes, we saw the number drastically go up, but there was no need to panic because we had an explanation why. In fact, the New York Times just put out a great article explaining of why we're looking at these numbers all wrong. We should not be looking at these numbers hour by hour, day by day. In fact, there's websites that are dedicated to tracking this and showing you where new cases are popping up. It's almost like they're gamifying the system. We don't need to do that. There's gonna be spikes in how we count. There's gonna be mistakes in how we count. There's a reason why I'm giving these updated numbers about every week or two, because otherwise it gets too confusing to track. If the WHO or CDC needs us to be alerted of something, they'll let us know. Otherwise, let those other websites panic. You stay alert, not anxious. There's been a lot of talk about the lethality or death rate when it comes to the COVID-19 virus. Let's talk about what that means. When someone becomes ill with any virus, there's a specific rate of those who have a mild illness, moderate to severe, or a critical one leading to death. When we look at the numbers currently for this COVID-19 virus, what we see is that 81%, which is by far the huge majority, are mild cases. 14% are moderate to severe, meaning that the patient will get a bacterial infection on top of it, a pneumonia, so on. And then 5% are critical cases, where those people can need respiratory support or even lead to death. What does all of that mean? In order to understand the impact that a virus has on a community, we look at a couple of measures. We look at how infective a virus is, meaning how likely is it to spread within the community, as well as its lethality rate. Now, one of the most deadly infections out there is Ebola. That is a 50%, about a 50%, because we've seen variations in this, 50% death rate. Then MERS, which is the outbreak that happened in 2012, 30%. SARS, 10%. For this virus, we're seeing around 2% fatality rate. And I wouldn't be surprised if that number goes down as we find more mild cases that we haven't diagnosed yet. Also, to put in perspective, the traditional influenza virus that we see here in the US, the seasonal flu, is 0.1 to 0.2% lethality rate. You've probably also heard on the news that there's been several cruise ships that have been quarantined to prevent the spread of the COVID-19 virus because someone on board was found to be sick. This is truly happening. There's actually some Americans that were found on some of these cruise ships and were brought back to the United States and held in quarantine. I think this is a great opportunity to talk about the difference between isolation and quarantine. Isolation is what we do in a medical facility, but you could do it technically anywhere, with someone who's already sick. Quarantine is what you do with someone who's either sick or you're not sure if they're sick and you prevent them from exposing themselves to other people. You can do a quarantine in a cruise ship, in someone's home, in an army base, as long as they're preventing spread of anything that they might have, that's considered a quarantine. Here's five new updates on the COVID-19 virus that I think you should know. Number one, packages. There's many people that have a fear, and rightfully so, of opening packages that have come from China and the worry that they may be infected with the COVID-19 virus. In looking at the testimony from experts from the NIH, CDC, WHO, it looks like our suspicion at the moment is that the virus only survives on surfaces for a few hours, much like the SARS and MERS viruses did as well. They are close cousins of COVID-19. That being said, if you're handling any packages from China, you should be washing your hands right afterwards just to be safe. The CDC did go on record and state that the primary spread of the COVID-19 virus is not through surface contamination, it's through respiratory droplets, so they seem to agree with the experts as well. That's good to know. Two, let's talk treatments. Since this is a virus and we currently have no treatments other than supportive care, like giving people fluids, making sure that they have respiratory support, or if they get a bacterial infection on top, we can give antibiotics. Right now, there are 80 trials trying to figure out which antiviral or antiretroviral therapies would work on COVID-19. In fact, there's a new study that just kicked off in Japan using HIV medications on the virus to see if that works. Look, the huge majority of these are gonna fail, but if we find promise even in some of these, that's gonna make a big difference in the long run. Three, vaccines. Since you know I'm a big fan of vaccines, and you should be as well, especially the flu vaccine, WHO recently went on record and said the COVID-19 vaccine is in the works and could potentially be completed 18 months from now. I know that sounds like a long ways away, but if the situation is to continue to worsen, it's good to know that we have hope from a vaccine on the horizon. In fact, we have some vaccines available now, but they're just going into the beginning trials now, and we wanna make sure they're safe. So we do tests on vaccines to make sure they're safe before we give them to the general public. Four. There is a ton of misinformation spreading across the web about the origins of the COVID-19 virus. There's even US senators that are trying to say that there's a potential for bioterrorism here. There is no evidence of this. And all that is doing is creating more panic and fear-mongering. We should only take evidence that we have now and use that to guide our further research. Do not put wild, unsubstantiated conspiracy theories out there because it just confuses us and really gives more ammunition to trolls on social media to create grabbing headlines and visuals to really misguide the general public. The current prevailing theory is still the one from my first video that this virus began in animals and jumped to a human source. Whether that happened in the Wuhan market, whether it happened in a Wuhan lab, it doesn't even matter if it was a bat, a pangolin, it doesn't matter which animal we're talking about. That's still the prevailing theory, and until it's disproved, there's no need to start thinking conspiracy theories. Five, don't believe in self-treatment. If you think that you may have the COVID-19 virus, contact a health professional immediately. The WHO just released a mega warning about this. There's things popping up on Instagram about vitamin C megadoses, herbal preparations, even smoking as a recommendation for this. There is no proof that any of this works, and in fact, it can put your life further in danger. Please contact a health professional if you think you may have been exposed to this and are experiencing symptoms. And also, I want to note that there's becoming a shortage of masks, both regular surgical masks and specialized N95 masks, because it seems like everyone is ordering them. Leave the equipment to professionals, people who truly need it. In fact, there's been 1,700 medical workers who've been infected by the COVID-19 virus. They're already facing significant risk. Do not make the problem worse by having them treat patients without proper protection. don't buy masks for yourself if you don't need them. And the CDC has been firm on this. Most people, the ones that are healthy and not sick, do not need a mask at this time. We're gonna keep the hashtag alert, not anxious going for this video. And if you wanna know the truth about allergies and food sensitivity tests, because that involves your immune system as well, click here for that video. I sat down with a world-renowned allergist and did an interview.